My name is Samir Gandesha, and I'm the director of the Institute for the Humanities. Welcome. It's great to see all of you here tonight. Obviously, there's a good 70 people who are not at home self-medicating and watching the debate. Of course, I think that there will be some thematic overlap between that debate and our talk tonight. But I think, obviously, they're going to be radically divergent. So it's really terrific to be able to, and really my pleasure to be able to welcome Shayna Plaut here tonight to give this talk for us, as she has done a number of things already with the Institute and has recently become an associate of the Institute. I'm very pleased to announce. But before I go on to announce our speaker and introduce her, I'd just like to say a couple of things about our upcoming program, or program that's really kind of in motion. And before I do that, though, I'd just like to acknowledge that this event is taking place on the unceded territories, the Coast Salish peoples, the Tsleil-Waututh, Musqueam, and Squamish nations. I'd also, in a sense, like to acknowledge that this is always a kind of a symbolic yet respectful gesture. It's important to do, but it's also important for universities, for now the city of Vancouver, municipalities like Vancouver, to make those symbolic gestures, but also to go beyond that symbolism. And I think this point was just made today by the Union of BC Indian Chiefs, Grand Chief Stuart Phillip in particular, in refusing to participate in a reconciliation event that involved the royal family, precisely because he thought that he and his organization would have been treated as props in a larger kind of spectacle, without there being any kind of reality or substance to the idea of reconciliation, at least heretofore. So I think this is really important to bear in mind, and it's something that, in terms of the Institute's orientation and programming, we're trying to do more and more work around Indigenous questions and issues as part of this larger project to indigenize the university, which I think is really a very important one. Our program, as some of you will know already, for 2016, 2017, is on the meaning of refuge. We've already had a number of events to this effect. In particular, our psychoanalysis lecture series is geared to looking at the question of otherness in the context of the migration and refugee crisis, although Shayna's going to tell me it's not a migration and refugee crisis at all, and that'll be an interesting discussion. We had recently, just last week, Johannes Merck coming from Vienna to talk a little bit about the forms of right-wing populism that have emerged in Europe recently. But of course, one can locate the emergence of right-wing forms of populism, not just in the last decade and a half, but you can actually trace them all the way back to the origins of neoliberalism itself in Reagan, Mulroney, and in particular the government of Margaret Thatcher. So there's a longer history to the really the demonization of the other, the demonization of the migrant, which of course goes right back to the middle of the last century, which is also an important horizon for us to consider. So just a couple of things to draw your attention to in terms of events that are coming up. We have the 2016 Mahatma Gandhi commemorative lecture with Judy Graves, and the lecture is entitled We Change the World, and this is a lecture that addresses her advocacy for homelessness, for the homeless on Vancouver's downtown east side. And this is going to happen October 3rd at 7 p.m. And this is not in this room, but rather on the first floor, room 1420, 1430. Registration is required. So if you're interested, please consider registering for that and coming out. And then later on, just about a week later, we have the Radical Convergence, SFU's Geography Department in the mid-70s. And we have speakers Nick Blomley and Eugene McCann from our Geography Department, really talking about the radical history of that department. I think it should be very, very interesting. And something to also think about around the Thanksgiving weekend, we have a major international conference on genocide, which will bring together considerations of genocide on the African continent, in the Indian subcontinent, and of course in North America. So I think that's highly relevant to our theme for tonight. That is October 7th and 8th. So all this information is up on our website, also on our Facebook page and so on. Something also for the next semester, if you are thinking that far ahead, we are sponsoring a Joanne Brown symposium on violence and its alternatives on the topic. It'll be a one-day conference symposium on the topic of the violence of detention, and that will be co-organized with, amongst others, known as illegal. So I think that should be very interesting and directly relevant to our talk this evening. And then around that time, a friend and colleague of mine from Carleton, William Walters, who's an expert on governmentality and migrancy within the context of Europe in particular, will be speaking. So those two events will go together very nicely. And again, they'll be essential components, as is this talk tonight, of our program on the meaning of refuge. So please look out for all of those events. So without any further ado, it gives me tremendous pleasure, as I said, to welcome Shayna Plaut tonight. Shayna's work sits at the intersection of academia, journalism, and advocacy. Her academic writing has been published in Racial and Ethnic Studies, which is forthcoming, Journalism Practice, Alternatives, Global, Local, Political, the European Educational Research Journal, and the International Journal for Human Rights, as well as chapters and books published by Routledge, IB Taurus, and Sage. She is a human rights editor for the Praxis Center, an online resource center for artists, academics, and activists, as well as people who identify as all three, where she writes, interviews, and solicits work that critically engages with the question of what change can be or what change can mean. As an educator, researcher, and journalist, Shayna has served as a consultant for the UN's Office of the High Commissioner for Human Rights, Amnesty International, and a variety of migrant and human rights organizations. Since 2014, Shayna has served as a research manager for Strangers at Home, a project for the Global Reporting Center. And this is going to be the topic of her talk this evening. She'll take you through this project. And I'm pleased to say this is the Canadian premiere. The world premiere was actually at the UN. But you will, of course, tell people more about that. I'm sure they'll be quite interested to hear about it. So without any further ado, please join me in welcoming Shayna Plaut.
First of all, thank you all very much for coming. Thank you for not sitting and watching the Trump and Clinton debate. I, as many of you know, I am American. I'm almost Canadian. I just got my FBI certificate yesterday, and therefore I'm sending everything in, and so I'm going to have the dual citizenship because my people have survived centuries by having contingency plans. And that's how we do it. So before I begin, I really do want to acknowledge the land that we're on. I mean, I'm doing a talk here called Strangers at Home, right? Current narratives and fear resistance in Europe. But when we're talking about strangers at home, all of us here are strangers on the land of the Musqueam, Squamish, and Tsleil-Waututh peoples. And recognizing that being a stranger is in and of itself a position, and it may be one where we can be a good stranger, where we can be a respectful stranger, or where we can be a stranger that we are making assumptions of where we belong. But we should recognize our position of where we are, right? And so I do want to begin that. I also really want to thank Samir and Huyen for hosting the Canadian premiere of Strangers at Home. My former students, thank you all for coming. You've heard about this for years. You've watched the franticness happen. My friends, and then also people who I have not had the pleasure yet of meeting. I'm really hoping that we can have an engaged conversation and dialogue. I'm also very bad at sitting and talking, so I'm probably going to get up and pace at some point. Take it as a sign that I am more comfortable. So let me begin here. Strangers at Home is a project of the Global Reporting Center, and I'm going to explain a little bit more about what that means later on. But basically, it started because my colleague, Peter Klein, who is the child of Holocaust survivors from Hungary, and myself, where I am the grandchild of people who left Europe because of persecution against Jews, and I've also worked with Roma, gypsy populations, Romani populations, for the past 15 years. And I've also worked with refugees and migrants for probably about, a long time. Let's just leave it at that. We were all following the news of what was happening in Europe progressively, and this rhetoric and this talk about Europe is turning to the right, and that actually it's 1938 all over again. That what was taking place was just a resurgence of Nazism and of the extremism there. And we were sitting and we were watching this in the North American news, and we're saying this doesn't seem quite right. First of all, when we're talking about 1938 all over again, that was a declared war, that was a declared invasion, that was a time when there's empires that were falling and fascism in that way, and it was also very direct. That's not actually what we were seeing. And also this talk of bringing up that it was 1938 all over again is actually trying to look at the present and trying to acknowledge the present through the lens of the past. So what is actually going on right now? And there was a number of other problems. Number one, in terms of the obviousness of it. But number two, when we're talking about Europe, what do we mean when we're talking about Europe? What is Europe? And I don't mean this from one of these esoteric questions, but I've done a lot of work, academic work, advocacy work in Europe. And I remember in one day once, I went from the Arctic, from right up here, where you can see those little red dots up over there. I went from the Arctic, where I was working with the Sami people, to go and fly to a wedding, a Romani wedding, down in the Balkans, down in Macedonia. So in 24 hours, I went from those little red dots up there all the way to that red dot in the country that's not even labeled, that's right next to Bulgaria. And in that period where I took the bus that was going from one part of the Arctic to the other part of the Arctic, the plane that was going from Oslo all the way down to Belgrade in Serbia, and then a train down to Macedonia, that 24-hour period convinced me there was no such thing as Europe, because it was so incredibly divergent. So when we're talking about that is 1938 all over again in Europe, that there's all of the rise of the right in Europe, my first question is, where are we talking about? We need to understand the context. We need to understand the political context, the social context, the cultural context, the histories, and also the futures. So how do we do that here in North America when most people wouldn't even know the names of the countries, let alone where they are, let alone those particular countries? I mean, I can blame it on myself. I'm American, right? You know, we really don't know anything. Canadians might be a little bit better, you know. But how does this work when you're then trying to do it into a soundbite, but doing it from the mindset and the vision that is already so limited? In other words, what stories are being heard and what stories are being ignored? And here, we have to understand that the dominant narratives that are being told in BBC, in CBC, in even The Guardian, you know, let alone some of the more, you know, right-wing news that we might want to make fun of because it's easier, those dominant narratives are supporting dominant power structures. And one of the things that we can really understand here is this notion of issue emergence and issue non-emergence. By that, by what I mean by that is that there is, as Charlie Carpenter says, a myriad of bad things happening there in the world. There's this whole collection of bad things. Which bad thing is actually going to turn into a story? And then which of those stories is actually going to turn into an issue? An issue that's actually going to be on the agenda. That's what we mean when we're talking about issue emergence, but also, most importantly, what do we mean when we're talking about issue non-emergence? What never makes it there? And then lastly, this notion of what's called culture talk. And those of you who are my former students, I'm sorry. Those of you who are my current students, this is a preview. By culture talk, what I mean is that there are bad things happening in the world. There are certain things that are taking place in the world. So, for example, Roma children are not graduating from secondary school. Okay, this is an indisputable fact. Why are Roma children not graduating from secondary school? Well, because their culture doesn't respect formal education. Okay, so what ends up happening is an issue that's taking place gets explained away by talking about their culture, as opposed to looking at the idea of, wait a minute, where are Roma children actually living? Are there roads that are actually going there? Are there school buses that are actually taking them there? When they actually get to school, where are they placed in the classroom? When they're actually placed in the classroom, how are they treated by the students? And when they graduate, are they going to be able to get a job? Those issues, when you're talking about roads, when you're talking about education, when you're talking about employment, those are political issues. What culture talk does is it explains away political issues by blaming their culture. And that is a theory that is put forward by Mahmoud Mamdani. So these notions of using culture talk, of explaining away political issues by blaming their culture, and we know that that takes place here in Canada all the time as well. That notion of culture talk, that theory, that notion of issue emergence and issue non-emergence, as put forward by Charlie Carpenter, and the more classical sociological understandings that dominant narratives support dominant power structures, these are the ideas that are framing, the academic ideas that are framing the notion of why we need to problematize, to make more robust, if we're going to use the academic speak, to really understand and get messy with what we mean about the rise of the right in Europe and how that's also being responded to. Okay? So, what stories are being heard, what stories are being ignored, and what stories are being silenced? I want to actually show you how some of the issues about the rise of the right in Europe are being handled in more left-wing, shall we say, more progressive often, shall we say, but still problematic.
It might not seem.
This is actually a clip from Al Jazeera, and it's looking at what's taking place in Hungary, and this is about this is about a year old, actually, at this point. Okay, so this is when the refugees were physically going through Hungary before the border had been set up. Okay.
It might not seem like it, but in little places like Martonfa in southern Hungary, the European vision of unity in dealing with the refugee crisis looks like a nightmare come true. You can see the village from this piece of Hungarian military land. The government has been investigating whether to set up a semi-permanent camp here for 1,000 refugees. But it's basically a bog, and even providing water would cost a fortune. For the mayor of the village, the idea that hundreds of men from the Middle East might be dumped here is a more immediate concern.
The vast majority are young, strong men. On their journey, they have some natural needs they haven't been able to satisfy, and there is a strong possibility, because of their cultural background, that they'll satisfy their needs in Hungary or Europe, but not in a European way.
There are hundreds of little places like this across Hungary and other Eastern European countries which have no money and no prospects. Boglarka is expecting a daughter soon, and she thinks the refugees could end up being offered more financial help than her baby.
Now suddenly people are coming from a totally different culture and they are entitled to aid. I understand refugees are in need, but I think a majority of Hungarians will be really upset because there will be too many of them.
10 minutes up the road is the much bigger town of Pécs. Those with a long memory might understand why Hungary's attitude towards refugees has more than a little irony attached to it. In 1956, when the Soviet army invaded Hungary, some of the fiercest resistance to them was here in Pécs, and thousands of people were either killed or had to run for their lives as refugees. But of course, that was 60 years ago. Now it appears a substantial part of Hungarian opinion thinks that the EU quota plan would put the wrong sort of refugees in their country. The logic of the quota plan means refugees already vulnerable potentially being placed in many cities in countries like Slovakia, where the far right is strong and they could easily be subject to attack. This recent demonstration featured signs saying, "Hang the refugees." In Martonfa, we asked the mayor what his opinion is now of the European Union. He said he'd show us and promptly took down the EU flag from the village hall and stuck it in a cupboard. How ironic that this supposed display of European unity could end up helping the far right and Hungary's growing friendship with Russia. Lawrence Lee, Al Jazeera, in southern Hungary.
So I wanted to share that with you because this is not Fox News, okay? This is, you know, Al Jazeera often considered more more critical in certain ways, and yet you could see some of the motifs that we were discussing in terms not only of what the mayor was saying, right? Like, obviously there are natural needs that are based on people's culture of why there's going to be rape. But you can also see that it's almost creating a caricature, in a way, of these Hungarians, you know, who are really just concerned about their money, and therefore they're becoming more and more fascist. And really, this is an issue of European Union versus national pride. And you end up setting up this us and them situation where people are almost speaking in a way of cue cards. But it's cue cards for an audience that is obviously a North American audience, right? We even ended with Russia, you know, so we can still have that kind of boogeyman in that way. So the question that I often have is when we're talking about something like the refugee crisis or the migrant crisis, is this actually a story about refugees? Is this a story about Hungary? Is this actually a story about the European Union? Where are the refugees or migrants' voices? Where are actually the fascist voices? There are people who also, there's a reason why they have chosen to join in a right-wing movement. Where are the voices of those people? Instead, we're speaking for them. So when we talk about something like the refugee crisis or the migrant crisis, and this is what Samira was referring to before, I actually often say, no, it's not a refugee crisis or migrant, it's a Europe crisis. And let's look at that. But how do we get to that? Right? Not everyone's going to go and spend their Monday nights going to lectures in really warm rooms at downtown Harbor Center. So one of the main things that we have to do is we have to stop thinking that there's going to be a story, the story. So rather than there being the story, what if we actually had storytellers? So rather than looking for the truth, what if we actually decided to listen instead and solicit various stories? Well, the problem is that when you do this through traditional media, it doesn't tend to pay very well. It's a lot of money. And it also means that the traditional journalist, the foreign correspondent, the person that's going to come up and get the story from you, all of a sudden, they don't become center stage anymore. And if you look at it, the traditional notion of international journalism, foreign journalism, the foreign correspondence, is a very colonial approach. I am going to come from the global north. I'm going to go to your country with my needs and my vision already in mind. I'm going to get your story from you. I'm going to then go home and package it, and then I'm going to sell it back to you. Well, you can do this with rubber, you could do this with gold, you could do this with tobacco, you could do this with humans, and you can do this with stories. The thing is that with stories, just like other forms of colonialism, it tends to get really messy and have policy and political implications. So what is another way of doing journalism? What if we could be focused on what Madeline Brisk calls narrative politics rather than abstract policies and politics? By that I mean, what if we can actually focus on the story and actually using the story as a form of recognizing it as a form of politics in and of itself, and also as a way of engaging in politics? So the story, the process of the story, the process of getting the story, the process of getting a narration, of both getting somebody to tell the story, but also how to listen to this story, this process is in and of itself political. And what if we could recognize that? And what if we can actually support that? And you see this in certain ways of things like long-form journalism, you'll see this. Sometimes in terms of radio, you'll see this. You'll hear that with radio documentaries. You'll kind of get that notion of pulling the story in. But it tends to be much harder if you're not already fluent in the language, if you're not literate, if you don't even know that there's a story that's there. And what also ends up happening, what ends up happening is that you will end up talking sometimes to people who already care. So this is Mirta Papalopoulos. She's an incredible photographer. She actually did one of the pieces that we're going to see later on. She actually embedded with migrants who were coming in from Greece and doing the Balkan route. And she embedded with them going all the way through Macedonia. Most of these migrants are actually Afghan migrants. And she followed them, and she just took their pictures and stayed with them to get their stories and used their stories as a way to then try and shape some of the politics. She published it in purpose in French because that's where the pressure needed to be. So when you see this, you don't need to know Greek, right? You can see something in this story already. The use of cartoons is another way. To be able, again, to reach through in a way where it's not people who are already going to care. So this is actually cartoons that were done by Alexander Zagrev. Alexander Zagrev is a cartoonist from Serbia. He chose to actually publish in English. This was actually published in a Canadian magazine on purpose when there was trying to shift some of the discourse regarding Syrian refugees. And then this is what we're trying to do through Strangers at Home, because that's actually why you're here, right? Okay. So, Strangers at Home, what this process is that we, and by we I mean the Global Reporting Center, actually put a call out for people in Europe who felt like they were strangers at home or had a story that they wanted to tell about being a stranger at home. We gave them 500 euro, which is a token amount, to basically make the story any way they wanted, in any medium that they wanted. And we wanted it to be their story, to explain to people outside what is going on, to explain not the what and the how, but also the why. So I'm going to actually show some of the clips right now. I'm going to start with Greeks, because we already saw Mirto's piece. And I'll show some of the clips, and then I'll give a bit of the backstory behind some of it, and then do this for a couple of the pieces, probably about four or five. I might let you vote on one of them. I don't know. It depends on how democratic I feel. And then I'll talk a little bit about one of the stories that's actually in the process of being made as we speak. And then I'd like to be able to open up the floor for some of those questions. Sound good? Yeah? Yeah? Are we hot? I'm always hot. I know I'm hot. Can we open up one of the windows? One of the doors? Is that possible? Can we open the window? Okay. And just so you know as well, this is available on online. So this is Myrto Papalopoulos, and this is in Greece.
Οι Έλληνες λοιπόν είναι όσοι γεννιούνται Έλληνες, και αυτό δεν μπορείτε να το αλλάξετε με κανένα νόμο. Σας ευχαριστώ.
The creation myth of connecting the classical past with the present is still alive. Everything different, such as migrants, is perceived as a threat to the nation's security.
Γυναίκα στην Αφρική ίσον πορνία.
Τα μυαλά θα αλλάξουν. Ο κόσμος πάει μπροστά, γιατί να μην πάει η Ελλάδα.
Αυτό το χέρια μπορεί καμιά φορά να χαιρετάνε έτσι, αλλά είναι καθαρά χέρια.
Τα δόντια σφίξε γερά και μη δακρύσεις. Εγώ το πήγα και το έφτασα στο τέρμα, και όπως γράφουν στα βιβλία οι παλιοί σοφοί, όταν θα φτάσει ο ήλιος στο τελευταίο γέρμα, θα βάλουνε φωτιά από ψηλά οι αετοί. Για σους με πρόδωσαν με πίσω μαχαιριές, θέλω να ξέρουν ότι και για αυτές τις αγάπες τις παλιές, θέλω να ξέρουν ότι
So as you can see in that film, what was being used on purpose was that of shock, right? And of purposeful juxtaposition, right? You're having somebody who is black speaking Greek. What's going on? Am I supposed to be shocked by this? Am I supposed to be surprised by this? You know, we're having somebody actually, you know, showing the classical Greek scenes, but then also they're in a hijab. How is this actually working? And it's using that juxtaposition on purpose. It's making people uncomfortable on purpose in order to then open up that conversation, right? Now, Myrto is a photographer, her partner is a filmmaker, so they're using this medium of film and of art in order to get that message across. But another piece that was done is that of trying to use this idea of the activist, and of using this idea of how do you convey something that's really complicated through a story? How do you convey something that's really, people who are not from abroad, but people who are strangers at home, but from inside? This is actually the story of what was taking place in the Czech Republic. And I'm giving you just a little backstory, because it was actually a joint project between a lawyer, who's originally from Slovakia, and an activist. And we were trying to then turn it into a story. And it was, took a while, but I think you'll see it.
Je to segregace a naprosto systematická, naprosto promyšlená.
Lehký, mentálně retardovaný.
Jsem byl naštvaný.
No, stydě se za to,
že jsem chodila, no.
To bylo automaticky, jo, že tam prostě ty Romové chodili do těch zvláštních škol.
Pokud ty děti tam jsou neoprávněně, oni, někdo jim ukradl jejich příležitosti, jejich možnosti, jejich život, kdo jim ho vrátí, kdo to narovná. Já jsem jedna z těch, kterým bylo doporučováno, aby šlo na zvláštní školy. V mojí lékařské zprávě se psalo, že jsem mentálně opožděná, že jsem retardovaná.
Now, I wanted to talk a little bit about this film because all of us have gone to school at some point or another, and we have seen this before, right? We are seeing this right now in Canada itself in terms of what's happening with Indigenous peoples and Indigenous children as well. Now, often what will happen, though, is that this could become very, very depressing. And it can become a little bit hopeless. And what I liked about this film and in trying to make this film was actually how do you show resistance as well? But how do you also show that this is a situation of the state justifying racism in the name of science? And that's a really complex idea. About saying that the state, that the institution is actually going to legitimate racism, is going to perpetuate racism, but in the name of science, in the name of helping in this way. And so that we went back and forth and back and forth between me and Edita, who does not speak English but speaks Czech and Slovak, and then also the lawyer who I was working with as well. How do we turn this into a story? And in the end, we decided Editha's story was the story, right? But it's a lot, right? It's a lot. And it's one of the reasons why when we talk about this project, I don't like to use the term xenophobia. And the reason why I don't like to use the term xenophobia is assuming that the people are coming from outside, right? That it's the fear of those from outside. Whereas many times the strangers are actually the people at home. Roma are people who are at home. Jews are people who are at home. One of the stories that is getting in the process of being made that I'll talk about not too much, but you know later, is actually about trans people in Slovakia. That's actually in the process of being made right now. These are people at home. But also some of the people who are feeling like strangers at home are the ethnic people of that country. So we had an ethnic Italian person who is the head of Casa Pound, one of the largest fascist groups in Italy, who feels like a stranger at home. And he wanted to tell the story. He wanted to tell his story. And we were sitting here being like, do we want to give a fascist 500 euro? And then we had to sit and think and be like, wait a minute. We might not agree with what he's doing, but there is a logic here. And we need to understand. You can't be against something if you're not listening to begin with. So here is what's going on, according to Stefano.
Mi chiamo Davide Di Stefano. E oggi è stato un lungo giorno.
Io questa terra non gliela do!
Capito? Gli italiani che difendono il loro quartiere!
Casa Pound è un gruppo nazionalista, il più grande d'Italia. noi dobbiamo lottare per i nostri diritti, contro l'immigrazione illegale, perché questa è la nostra terra. È per il popolo italiano che lottiamo. Perché la gente sta diventando sempre più povera e sempre più umiliata dal degrado. Ma con ogni pasto e in ogni lotta, la gente vede che Casa Pound sta con loro.
Se danno una mano, la miglior cosa, ben vengano in Casa Pound.
Perché noi siamo loro.
And this was an interesting situation, right? And you can see, like, this medium was actually a joint project done by somebody who works with NPR and with some of the more traditional journalism, and David. And it was, you could see it's a more traditional journalistic piece, right? So the first one is more artistic. It's film. It's using music. It's using those skills of the artistic side of it. The second piece is really very much trying to get a political message across through a story. Here, this is a much more traditional journalistic piece, and trying to kind of get what we named it, fascist logic, get the logic behind the fascist. So now I'm going to open it up in terms of, you're gonna vote. Would you like to see a piece from the point of view of a 19-year-old young man? It was about something that happened to him in school. Or would you like to see a piece that was done by a cartoonist? Both are actually looking at the issues of anti-Semitism and complex issues of anti-Semitism, one in Sweden and one in Serbia. So cartoonist or a 19-year-old young man? 19-year-old young man. Cartoonist. Really? Both?
Yes.
Okay, I'm going to start with the 19-year-old young man because I got more of the votes. This is by far, and I'm saying this with all respect, the weakest of the videos, by far. Basically, I had heard a radio audio piece, and it was done on the CBC on Sunday morning, you know, is it Ideas, I think? And I heard this piece, and I stopped. I was washing dishes, and I completely stopped washing the dishes. And I was like, oh, man, I need to get the story. And it was in July, and it was in Sweden. And everybody is on holiday in July in Sweden. And so I stalked these people, literally. I found their phone number through Google and then started calling every single person with this name and then caught them in their summer home and convinced them in their summer home that they should tell their story, except that they're in Sweden, they're in Malmo, Sweden, I'm in Vancouver, they're on holiday. So this was done with me asking questions over a smartphone on speaker while somebody sat there with a still camera. And then we actually asked this young man, Jonathan, to go take pictures with his iPhone. He just didn't know that he's supposed to leave the camera still. So he's doing everything past. So I'm saying all this to say, artistically, this is not the best story. But the story, I think you'll get it in and of itself. That was a very good disclaimer, right?
My name is Jonathan. I'm 19 years old. I live in Sweden, and I'm Jewish.
I was walking down the hallway and a gang with people came and asked me, "Are you a Jew?" And I said, "Yeah, I'm a Jew." Suddenly they started pushing me, screaming horrible stuff, threatening me and my family to death.
I
It's forbidden to talk about that. You cannot accuse any group of doing more anti-Semitic crimes because then you're a racist.
I want to do something about the anti-Semitic problem here in Malmö.
Salam, shalom, guten tag.
A guy that's very known for fighting against anti-Semitism said that he would be glad to come to my school. When I proposed that to my principal, he said no. He don't want to have anyone think that there's a problem here. If you can't see the problem, then there is no problem.
So this is a really interesting story, because there is anti-Semitism in Malmö, and there is a large wave of immigrants in Malmö. And what's happened is that a connection has been made between policies in Israel and anti-Semitism. And this guy, Sarovash, who himself is Muslim, is Swedish, his parents were immigrants, basically was like, hold on, you can criticize political policies without actually hating a group of people. And he has actually done a lot of education in Muslim communities as well as in ethnic Swedish communities to try and detangle this. So when Jonathan was facing anti-Semitism in his high school, he said, hey, let's go bring in Salavash. And it was the ethnic Swedish principal who said, no, 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 then people are going to think there's a problem. Well, that's a really complex and interesting story that you're not going to get on a quick 60 seconds on the National. And that's a very, very different story than what you're going to see, for instance, in Serbia, where there is a lot of anti-Semitism, but no Jews. Well, very few.
In my comics, I've been trying to reflect on Serbian past and present, from the time of the inbred nationalism of Milosevic in the 90s until the present time bigotry of the football hooligans, who hate Jewish people without seeing one in their entire life, because most of them were actually eradicated during the Nazi occupation in the 1940s, so now it's almost impossible to meet a single Jewish person in Serbia. So some of these absurd situations, they ended up in my comics. In one of my comics, I speak about the fate of the Jewish people, and especially about the girl whose name was Hilda Deitch, who died in the concentration camp in Belgrade during the 40s.
So this is Alexander Zagrev, whose real name is Sasha Rakic, but he goes by Alexander Zagrev. You might have recognized his cartoons from what I showed previously. He's not Jewish. And he was, and his interest is, how are we hating people who we don't even know? How is this happening? Again, that's not something that's going to come across. It's not in a quick new headline. That's not going to come across in something that's asking how and asking why and asking what we don't know is not the way that we traditionally understand news, but it is the way that we understand stories. I'm going to end this portion. There's more. There's a lot more. I'm going to end this portion, though, by something that with something that I think is really important, which is, how are journalists themselves responding to this? And this is a group of journalists in Germany who have Muslim last names, who receive a whole lot of hate mail. And this is what they do with it. And this is also partially why I think that understanding different forms of resistance becomes really important.
We think that there is a problem with Islamophobia in Germany, and our show is one of many possible ways of confronting that. we are reacting in a way that we know we are good at. You know, we are journalists, we know how to deal with the public. Hate mail comes with every article that we write.
Es gibt tatsächlich auch mal Tage, wo ich keinen bekomme. Es gibt aber Tage, wo ich 500 Kommentare bekomme.
Die Leute, die abends immer dann auf der Bühne sind, die bekommen diese Hassbriefe eben, weil man sie in die Kategorie Türke, Araber, Muslim, keine Ahnung, Kurde reinpackt.
A lot of Islamophobia is really just blatant racism in disguise.
Und du? Du bist eine türkische Islammuschi.
Steck dir deine Parole Islam ist Frieden hinten rein. Es ist höchste Zeit, dass man bei der Zeit solche linken Gehirnwichser aus der Redaktion entfernt.
99,999% der Deutschen wollen sie nicht.
Wir haben den Scheiß, den wir privat kriegen, in die öffentliche Umlaufbahn zurückgeschickt.
So, that's, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, those in between, those who don't like categories and others. That is the story behind the stories. And that's the storytellers themselves. And again, I'm happy to discuss other stories that are and that we have here, some really complex things. How do you have somebody who is Roma and is one of the most famous Yugoslavian singer in the world talking about what it means to grow up as Roma, but also supporting a very right-wing government right now? How do you then make the judgment about, is she actually talking about Roma? Is she not? Is she being propaganda for the government? These were some of the decisions that we had to make in the process. When do you have a lawyer in Russia who on his spare time on the weekends trains people how to be paramilitaries to go and fight the invaders that are coming, right? Do you show that story? Do you not? These are some of the decisions that we made in the process. But it's also this process of making stories by engaging with storytellers who you may or may not agree with, but it's not about you. If we're going to talk about what's happening about strangers at home and people who are feeling like they are strangers at home and really identifying this, what is on the agenda, what is not on the agenda, how things are framed, how things are silenced, where does the power and the politics lie, and then how can we actually support resistance that's going to be effective? If we're going to do that, then we have to listen. We have to take a step back. But that doesn't mean that we're not existent. We are creating a space. So the Global Reporting Center is equipped with very seasoned journalists, very eager students, and a lot of people with a lot of passion that probably runs it more than anything else. And it got the attention from the United Nations Office for High Commissioner of Refugees, as well as the United Nations Human Rights Council and the United Nations Office for Human Rights. They found our website online. They invited us to come. Some of you know it was in April. It was crazy. I found out I was going about 6 hours before I got on the plane. And we actually presented Strangers at Home there, and it was being used now for the UN Secretary General's campaign against xenophobia. The Council of Europe actually found the website. And because these are shorts, asked if they could use them in their youth trainings. So this is the Council of Europe that is engaged in youth summits and youth trainings, and they said, can we please use your shorts to facilitate conversation and discussion? So in one way, it's actually influencing policy by the UN Secretary General. I don't know what a campaign against xenophobia looks like, by the way, and I very strongly vocalized my concerns with that. But it's also being used in terms of content and generating discussion. So it's being used in terms of content as well as being used as catalyst. And now I ask you for your questions and how you would like to be able to use this. So thank you very much.
I think this is just a wonderful presentation, not least because it manages to avoid some of the moralism that I think has really penetrated our political discourse. And what I mean in particular is your insistence on the importance of understanding, of course, the stories and listening to the stories of refugees, but also listening to the stories of let's say, their persecutors, those who are attracted and, let's say, seduced by the messages of the far right. I think we really do have to understand this. And I think this is what's at issue in the United States right now with the phenomenon of Trump. The more the liberal media moralizes and condemns Trump, the stronger his support, in a sense, becomes, right? And it just simply reinforces the idea that he's appealing to people who have, in a sense, been forgotten. And they really have. I mean, there's this wonderful book. I haven't read it, but I've heard a lot about it.
oh, how academic.
J.D. Vance, hillbilly memoir. And he talks about growing up in the Appalachians and really being completely forgotten for generations, you know, and I think this is in some way what Trump is tapping into. So that's a really important dimension to your presentation, but also the depiction of the ravages of austerity. I mean, these are real. So European countries are being destroyed by, especially Southern European countries, they're being destroyed by austerity. But at the same time, they're shouldering more and more of the burden of integrating and accommodating refugees, right? And so I think this is one of the great contradictions. And I think you're absolutely right to point out that this is a crisis not just of not just a refugee crisis, a migrancy crisis, but it's one of Europe. And we see this with Germany and the contradictory position of Germany, right? On the one hand, being the most welcoming of refugees, right? Over a million refugees or so have been taken in, no caps, even after these attacks. Merkel has held the line. It might be to her ultimate political downfall, but she's taken up a very principled stance vis-a-vis convention, you know, UN convention and conventions and the obligations to them. But at the same time, she's really put the boots to Greece. And so this is a big contradiction. I think it magnifies the problem that Europe is going through right now. So I think, in a sense, the resistance has to, in some way, be both a resistance to austerity and a resistance to the xenophobia that it creates. Again, you know, I use that term advisedly. One question now, and then I'll open it up. I was quite interested in hearing what you had to say about Europe and how amorphous it is. But is it really that amorphous? And I'm thinking back, and these debates are in a sense still ongoing, but greatly muted now, about the ascension of Turkey into the European Union. It's already an important NATO ally, and has wanted, with a kind of ambivalence, to be sure to be part of the European Union. Mm-hmm. And I think that's where Europe becomes defined, really, in terms of a common kind of Christian heritage, right? Which then becomes a kind of barrier to Turkey. It also explains its historical anti-Semitism and incapacity, really, to fully include Jewish communities. In fact, exactly the opposite, right? So I think that I'd like to hear what you have to say about that, that this is, in a sense, you know, the dominant narrative of Europe, one of one grounded in some understanding of the Christian world, right? The Holy Roman Empire and so on. So that's my question. And then should we have maybe three questions in a row, and then you answer them, and then another round? Yeah. Who is up next? Yeah.
Thank you, Shayna. Thanks very much. So this was a really interesting and stimulating conversation, and I like how you framed it very much, and the whole purpose around narrative and how complex narrative is and how multiple perspectives are important to take into account. And I want you to just discuss a little more about where you ended off. First, why the decision to try and represent narratives in such brief snippets because of course what you've avoided in these in a lot of ways is, you know, not presenting them as sound bites. These do not come across as essentialized, look, this is the story, which obviously can be a very polarizing approach in you agree or you disagree, and then you invite paralysis as a result of that polarization. Mm-hmm. So I don't think these do that at all. It's quite obvious they don't. But they present conundrums, really, quite open-ended conundrums, which we would expect would spur, catalyze, as you say, conversations. But even to do that is very difficult from a conundrum, because there can also be a different kind of paralysis introduced, which is these are so open-ended, they're so contingent, they're so complex. Really, how do we take this forward? How do we move to this conversation that is productive? So I think, obviously, there's a risk there as well. So if you can discuss how these are being used or how you envision them to be used to actually spur productive conversations.
Okay. Thank you. I'm just wondering that when we see the problem, individuals are the problem, when we address the problem, we are seeking for the answers. So there's problem, then what? Like how we can like make agreement for all of them and going in progress and good, like create better world. How we can create and progress. That shows clear problem, but it doesn't really show any answers for the future.
Okay,
Shayna,
why don't you go ahead and answer those,
and we'll have another round. Sure. I can do that.
Well, Liz, I wish I had a very deep answer for you. It's money. Basically, what will happen, and this kind of goes to your question as well, in a little bit, Johan, is that we had no money. We crowdsourced funded this. And so by crowdsourced funding it, what we could do is that we could give a small honorarium, which was 500 euros, to the storytellers. And we said, look, we know that, you know, 500 euros in Sweden is a lot different than 500 euros in Macedonia, for one, you know, what it can buy you. We want to give you something, but this is what we can do. And we said, make the 60 to 90 second pieces, and what we're going to do is put it together into what's called a sizzle reel. And then we're going to shop it to various production companies to try and get money to then make a larger feature film. And the larger feature film will still be different stories and still be different storytellers, but they're going to be about, you know, 10 to 15 minutes each, right? So then what it becomes is actually a feature film that you could see on the festival circuit, which is still only speaking to a particular audience, right? And it also could be something, though, that could be on the website, so that if you have a particular interest, let's say, in what's happening with refugees itself, then you can search, and there's going to be the tags to go and come up with the ones on refugees. If you have a particular interest in what's happening with Roma, then you can search and come up with the ones with Roma. If you have a, you know, et cetera. So you can search it based on geographic area. Let's say you're more interested in the Nordic countries. Let's say you're more interested in the Balkans. Or you could do it based on thematic and group and stuff like that. So that it actually becomes a multifaceted pedagogical tool, depending on the forums and the context that you're operating in. If you're operating at Doxa, you're going to watch a full-length film. And then you're going to hopefully have a panel discussion afterwards, blah, blah, blah. And then hopefully people actually stay for the panel discussion and, you know, everything like that. If you're going to be using it in an anthropology classroom, if you're going to be using it in a narrative history classroom, if you're going to be using it in a Balkan history classroom, if you're going to be using it in a political science classroom or journalism, it's going to be different. At the same time, if you need something that's very short, if you need that catalyst, like what the Council of Europe needed, you have that at your fingertips too. And I bet some of these are going to wind up as certain kinds of PSAs, public service announcements. Because it could also work there. So it basically enables you to have a growing body of narratives. There is a danger, of course, in whose hands it goes into. But in the gestalt, I think you can see what the point is. So that's that. Money. In terms of we see the problem and what are the solutions? If you're asking, Johan, what is the solution regarding feeling like strangers at home, I can say that part of it is recognizing that there is not a solution. I think part of it is seeing that it's economic, seeing that it's a history, a historical legacy of an idea of Europe and as Christendom that is no longer politically correct to speak about, but yet heavily influences the policies in a latent way until you literally have people walking from the Middle East into Europe, and Time magazine calls it the new exodus. It's not so subtle then, right? And then until you have the current president of Slovakia saying there is no place in Europe for Islam. It's not so subtle then. And then what ends up happening is that the piece that we're working on right now, like I literally just got the rough cut today, it's like really rough, which is why I didn't show it, is actually a Slovak young journalist. She's 25 years old. She's not trans, but she was particularly interested in what was happening in Slovakia because trans people in Slovakia, if they want to have their government documents actually match that of how they identify themselves, they need to go through the surgery and they need to be sterilized. Slovakia is in the European Union. The president of Slovakia is saying that there is no place for Islam in Slovakia. So this young lady who's Slovak, again, not trans-identified and not Muslim that I know of, basically said, hold on, are the same people who are pushing forward these bills and protesting the gay pride parade the same people who are protesting the refugees? The same people who are protesting the migrants? And if so, can the migrants and refugees actually learn something from the burgeoning trans movement in Slovakia? Because here are ethnic Slovaks who literally cannot exist, who are literally strangers at home, who are basically calling on some of the fundamental questions about gender and sex and saying, we demand to be seen. We demand, we have nothing left to lose. You're already taking away our ability to reproduce. Is there something then that refugees and migrants who are physically facing walls can learn from this trans movement? And questioning that. And that's the piece that's in the process. Now, well, I don't know why you're doing that. Come on now. Going back to what is the problem and the solution, I would say looking at it from the economic standpoint, looking at it from the cultural standpoint, looking at it from what's not being said and what's being kind of hidden there, and then actually shutting up and listening. That's a really big part of, I think, some of the solution. The solution that I can try and offer in my humble way is that of another way of doing journalism. And that's what I'm trying to offer as a solution. Can journalism be done in a different way? And that's what we're trying to do here. The last thing that I would say in terms of just what is actually happening with refugees and migrants in Germany specifically, is that of the UN Convention on the Rights of Refugees says that if a person is fleeing persecution on the basis of race, religion, political opinion, nationality, or member of a particular social group, then a country has to take them in. The EU made up something else, which is the Dublin Treaty, that said that if a person lands in Europe and it becomes registered as a refugee in Europe, then whatever the first country is that they go to, they have to stay there. They cannot actually seek refugee status anywhere else. So the UN actually says, you know, if you're fearing for persecution, just go. Like, go and a country has to take you in. The EU then said, no. We don't want people shopping for the best refugee status. So basically, wherever they land and get registered, they have to stay there. That's the Dublin Treaty. That's why you have people from Eritrea who are landing in Malta and landing in Italy and burning off their fingerprints. so that they can make it to Sweden and Norway, because that way they can't be registered. That's a political decision that actually is in contravention of international law.
Thank you so much. Great talk. I was wondering if the crisis was not in the Middle East and was not in an Islamic context, if the crisis was in East Asia or like in a non-Muslim Central Asian country, would that be it? Would we see anything that different, like the reaction that you're seeing from the EU countries? Like, I'm wondering how much is this because of Islam and how much of it is because of other reasons? What do you think of that?
So I'm just curious about the mechanics of how you found these people. How did you advertise this?
Is this on? Yeah. Okay. I was looking at the website just now, and it says particularly the introduction says something like xenophobia, like anti-Semitism and all that, and particularly on Europe. But if you're focusing on xenophobia, are you planning on expanding it? Or is it just like Europe because of Syrian refugee problems right now?
Okay. I'm going to put, I'm sorry, what's your name?
Nami.
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 Yeah.
Okay. Nami. And what's your name? Mohammed. Okay. I hate saying hey you. Like, it's like, all right. So I'm going to answer Leslie and Nami's question together, and then I'll go to yours, Mohammed. Okay. So this idea, how much true confession should we do? Lots of true confession? All right. Okay. Hopefully, you know, it'll make... So this actually started in around 2011, way before, not way before the problems in Syria. Like, that started with, I don't know, the Cold War and supporting dictatorships and, not paying attention to what was going on. But it actually started in 2011. And it really started off with this conversation between Peter Klein, the founder of the Global Reporting Center, and myself, where we were watching the coverage in US and Canadian and European media, and being like, this is really overly simplistic. And at the time, what was getting the coverage was the Golden Dawn in Greece. That happened to be what everyone was obsessed with at that time. I go back and forth to Europe quite a bit because of my research. I've worked with Roma and Romani media and Romani activism for about 15 years now. And I was just, I was just seeing a lot of stories that were not being told, and I was also seeing a lot of danger. I was seeing this rise of the right and this rise of nationalism and this rise of a rigidity that wasn't coming across here in North America, but I was also seeing this amazing resistance. This like amazing, beautiful resistance of people being like, no, this is not going to be happening in our country. People like Saravash, who are like, absolutely not. I am going to purposely detangle anti-Semitism and criticism about Israeli policy. That story was not being told, right? And so it was very Europe specific in that way because of where Peter and I were coming from. And also because of in some ways, the access that we had to multiple mediums. So Peter speaks Hungarian, I speak Romani, I'm going back and forth all the time, I'm having these friends, and I'm like, wait a minute, this is really dangerous. And it was also dangerous because, historically, of this idea of, the West versus the rest, that's partially, Mahmoud Mamdani as well, because of Christian Europe and, the Turkish invaders that are coming with the Ottoman Empire. History is very much alive in current politics, whether we want to see it or not. And to actually bring voice to that, I think, is quite important. That said, the European Union, I haven't forgotten your question, Leslie. That said, the European Union itself is trying to have its cake and eat it too. It's trying to have a economic market and economic policies, forgetting that people exist. And there is no uniform migration policy in Europe. There is no uniform refugee policy in Europe, except whoever gets them first. And what we're going to do is make sure that you get them first, you being Italy, Malta, and Spain to some extent. So I don't understand how you think you're going to have a common market and not think that humans are going to come with the market. And I actually wrote an article about this in the Praxis Center, where I said between the border of policies and people, where you have to recognize that people are affected by policies and that policies are made by people. And the way that you tend to do that is through story. So do I think that if all of a sudden there was a migration of people coming from Burma and Nepal walking over? Yeah, I think that'd be a problem too. Because there's an economic, a harmonized economic market without recognizing that economies have people. At the same time, there's great disparity within the countries of Europe as well as between the countries of Europe. And that's why you're seeing a lot of the rise of nationalism within Europe, because there is not a... There is not a harmonized European policy. Now, where you're seeing this rise of nationalism tends to be very much on the local level. So it's interesting. Slovakia and Hungary are in some ways strange exceptions, in the sense that a lot of the presidents of Europe on the national level will support European Union, at least in rhetoric, but it's the villages that won't. And it's the villages that have actually been really deeply affected by economic policies. You have a lot of internal migration of people from the rural areas going to the cities, to the capitals, and then being pretty much decimated. That is not an Islamophobic specific issue. That said, absolutely, you know, on the gates of Vienna, banging on the gates of Vienna, and that whole story of the Turks are coming is alive and well, you know. But I think that it'll just be colored in a different way. So there's that. The mechanics. Oh boy, okay. So some of this started with me knowing that there were particular storytellers that had great stories to be told. Mirta Popolopoulos. I just wanted an excuse to be able to show her really pretty pictures. You know, Mirta Popolopoulos had actually embedded with the Golden Dawn. She also was really interested in what's happening and she's ethnically Greek, she was also really interested in what was happening in the brothels in Greece and the different treatment of sex workers who were coming from Africa, specifically, who were transgendered specifically, and how they were being treated by the Greek clients as opposed to those sex workers who were ethnically Greek. And she was literally embedding in that way of, like, in the most intimate moments, how is this taking place? I'm like, we just need to get you on. I don't care what you want to do. Just come on. And she ended up being amazing, an incredible person to work with. I also have an intellectual crush on Alexander Zagreb, and I'm kind of obsessed with his work. I make my students read his work all the time, wanted an excuse to have him as well. But that's it. Those are the only ones where we actually chose. Otherwise, what we did is we put this call out using social media, and basically using Twitter, using Facebook, using all of the resources and contacts that we have, the vast resources and contacts that we had, and said, do you have a story to tell? And then people pitched their stories. And we put together an actual team of these people right here, you know. Some of these people right here, of people who were experts because they were academic experts. So Safia is an academic expert in terms of with the Balkans. She works particularly on queer issues in the Balkans and film. Nedim is a journalist who's originally from Bosnia and is now working for Radio Free Europe. So we did this kind of mixture. Nick makes films. We did this mixture of people to help us choose various pitches. And that's how we actually did it. And then we selected it. It was interesting who didn't come. We got nothing from France. We got nothing from Norway. We got nothing. We got one from the UK. So it was really interesting also to see who responded themselves, who saw themselves as storytellers. I mean, the fact that we got nothing from France when, like, was really shocking, actually. So there we go. That was long-winded. I'm sorry.
You talked a little bit in the beginning about kind of preaching to the choir.
Yeah.
And I feel like that's kind of what's happening here. You talked about like these videos being picked up by the United Nations Human Rights Council, and like most of us here are probably like more towards like the left side of the political spectrum. Whereas like in the meantime, like the mass media is still feeding the same simplistic messages to everyone else. So how do you get messages like this to like the other side of the spectrum? Have you thought about that?
And what's your name? I'm sorry?
Safter.
And before we go further, I think it would make sense just for people to introduce themselves.
Yeah. Before they ask. Thank you.
Hi there. My name is Farshid, UBC student. Thank you for your presentation. Loved it. I had a question that sort of would relate to a fellow audience. Gentleman over there that asked. Now that we understand the mechanics of your work and of your project, where are you hoping to take this project? What are you hoping to achieve in the short term? And again, you know, it's good to have this momentum happening, but if you don't direct it into appropriate means, the appropriate ways, it will just die out slowly. And you know, a professor of mine once said, it's not like there's a shortage of good people in the world,
right,
or good leaders and so forth, but things don't seem to be happening as much as we wish to, you know. Thank you.
Thanks. My name is Laura. I teach at the Vancouver School of Theology. And amazingly, my question weaves beautifully with the last two. Shayna, if we're really, really moved by your talk and are beginning to develop faith like you in the power of storytelling, that we can really create understanding, what are some of the other public squares in which we can facilitate the telling and hearing of stories? Thanks.
Great. I'm going to do this backwards. or actually, I'm just going to kind of weave them together. So, thank you. Those are great questions. What are other ways to engage in storytelling? I was kidding and not kidding. When I said one of the most powerful ways to engage in storytelling is to shut up, and like to really listen, but to listen also means to listen to people who you don't necessarily agree with, you know. I mean, like, you know what you're saying, you know, soft there, like to really listen. It means like to put yourself in uncomfortable positions, and then to be like, I'm okay with being uncomfortable. And what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna try and understand where is this person coming from and where is this person in relation to other dimensions of power. And also understanding that a person can both have power or not have power at the same time, right? And then the intersectionality of power. I'm not saying anything new. Thank you very much, you know, Patricia Hill Collins. Thank you very much, Sandra Harding. Yeah, we got it. Rock on, bell hooks, you know? But it's really just kind of understanding that when we're engaging in storytelling, it doesn't just mean going, and with all respect to the Vancouver Public Library and that they have an Indigenous storyteller, it doesn't just mean that, but it's actually listening to the stories of Indigenous peoples, not when you're going out looking for them. And it also means being, if not friends, being present when you don't agree. So we do this in lots of different ways. You know, we do this as siblings. We do this as lovers. We do this as students. We do this as children. We do this as professors. We do this in the grocery store. We do this on the bus. You know, that's actually where I think that storytelling kind of happens. And it also means that when you're hearing a story and you don't understand, that you actually say, can you explain that in a different way? I'm not quite following you. Like, I think I'm understanding from my point of view, but can you say that some other way? I mean, I try and practice this, and I don't know if I do it well. I try and practice this with my students sometimes. When a question is asked, and I'm like, can you say that in a different way? And I don't mean like you're not making sense. I mean, I don't understand. So is there another way that you can say this so that maybe I can understand, right? Because I really want to understand. But it's also recognizing that stories are reflections and are creations of realities. So that power actually happens in storytelling, but it also means that, like, what are you gonna do with it, right? What I, and recognizing where we're coming from. So what I can do with it as a journalist slash academic, what I can do with it is try and change journalism and try and show a different way of doing journalism. That's my little tiny puny contribution to the world. Is that I want to show that there's another way that you can do journalism, you know, and by showing it through modeling it. Other people might be able to do it through policy of, I don't know, education. Other people might be able to do it through policy about how domestic violence shelters work. Other people might be able to do it through soccer teams. I have a colleague right now in Germany who's doing it through going to really rural areas of Germany that are losing a lot of their population and basically saying, if you don't bring in refugees, you're no longer going to have a fire department. You're no longer going to have a soccer team, and you're no longer going to actually have a hospital. So if you'd like to keep your hospital, your soccer team, and your fire department, you might want to have young, virile people. Which you don't have right now because you're old and you're getting older. And then all of a sudden these communities in Germany are like, oh yeah, it's in our best interest to actually bring in refugees.
We like our pensions too.
Exactly, right? We want people to be working and kicking in. And so that's another way of doing it, and that's an economic argument, right? This person actually happens to be somebody coming from a business background. So that's a totally different way of engaging in change. One of the things that kind of shocked me was how much the people from, I don't know if you want me to show you the Russian one, right? I might not, because there's questions, you know, and I see that. But how many, like, David Stefano from Italy and this guy from Russia, they are so excited that their stories are being told. They are the most active on Twitter with this. So it is reaching some eclectic audiences. The thing is that there's no way to just show this video without actually showing the whole website. So people are seeing it in context. And I think that part of it is because it also feeds into this idea of otherwise it becomes, oh, it's just the left just talking to itself. To actually have a forum where people are showing these other positions.
Can I just ask a very quick follow-up? I know there are other questions here. We do have a bit of time. But just a very quick follow-up question. I really like what you just said there, that we can at least be present to those with whom we disagree. Quick question. Do you think that we're becoming less and less capable of doing that? I mean, how many Facebook posts, for example, do we see where I'm going to say this, and if you disagree, just unfriend me, or you unfriend people from Twitter, or, you know, in the classroom, this takes a whole set of different shapes and forms over offensive, uncivil speech, the need for trigger warnings on things that will be controversial or possibly, psychologically disturbing. That obviously has a legitimate claim, and that must be taken seriously and discussed. But it can also be seen as a way that, of not going into a terrain where you may feel uncomfortable because the positions are opposed to yours, right? Yeah. Do you see that presence as retreating? You can go right ahead and answer then.
In some ways, yes, and in some ways, no. To be present takes time. And I think that time is retreating. I can answer this with a story. You know,
it's appropriate.
When I first came to Canada, I came straight from Chicago. And if I'm loud and present now, I was quite loud and present then. And I really had no idea what I was walking into, where I was, etc. And I remember I ended up, we don't need to see that right now, thank you. I ended up in a class and I was looking around the classroom and I was really surprised because about two-thirds of the class were people of color. And I was like, oh, this is cool. This is like reminding me of home. And then the professor came in and the professor was a person of color. Like, wow, great, you know, awesome, this is good. And then everyone kind of started saying their name, and they were names like, you know, Amy Parent or David Kirk or, Francine Burney, and these names of that didn't sound like they were quote unquote particularly ethnic names. And then I just got really confused, and I was like, was everybody adopted? Is everybody married to white guys? What's happening? You know, what's going on? And then the professor said, well, welcome to the indigenous methodology course. And I was like, okay, whoa, how did I get here? What's happening? And I raise my hand up and I say, am I in the wrong class? And the professor says, well, I don't know, Shayna, are you in the wrong class? And I said, well, I don't know, am I on the list? And she said, yes. And I said, oh, well, then I guess I'm in the right class because I should be learning about Canada from the people who are actually from here, and I should be learning about education and methods from the production knowledge from the people who are actually from here. But you see, coming from Chicago, I literally didn't even know what I was looking at. I didn't know who I was looking at. My eyes were seeing people who kind of looked maybe Latino or Filipino. Like, I really didn't know. And I didn't know the history. And I made a complete ass out of myself. but then I was willing to stay. And I learned a lot, and I learned a lot from a position that I wouldn't have learned if I hadn't voted myself out. So I guess that was a long-winded way of saying, are we becoming less capable of being present? I don't think we're becoming less capable. We might be becoming less willing. And that's different, because we can change that.
Okay. Yeah. All right. Very interesting. Yes. If you could please just pass that.
Hi, Shayna. Thank you so much for this. My name is Julie, coming from UBC. And my question is about discomfort.
Discomfort?
Yes. So bear with me. You started by saying that you're American and about contingency plans. And then you traced your ancestry. You said you come from ancestry that was persecuted in the Second World War, as well as Peter Klein. And then we started to talk about strangers at home, which is the title of your talk. So I was thinking about how you and Peter are thinking about strangers at home. I'm thinking about power. I'm thinking about contemporary identity and how European identity is complicated. People who trace back, people who say live here, have been living here for generations, are they still strangers? Are they strangers at home? What does it mean to have the power to go and get stories from there and select stories and choose which ones to tell? Who's the stranger?
Hi, I'm Prod, and just going back to you mentioning that France didn't make it, and Norway didn't make it, and there was only one story from the UK. Do you have any insights regarding that as to why that might be the reason? Yeah.
Hi, I'm Ted. I'm Ted. And my question is about kind of media representation. A lot of, you know, traditional news media presents, as you made it pretty clear, stories in kind of a black and white, very simplistic manner. And a lot of that, I think, kind of comes from the almost this kind of illusion that news media is unbiased and meant to show the truth. But in reality, a lot of news media just isn't. There is like an underlying bias to that. And my question is, for these stories to really get shared on a large basis, do you think that we should kind of stop this kind of almost illusion of news being unbiased? Because these stories, as they are personal, they are inherently biased. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So we have this round, and we'll see where we're at. Mm-hmm. Another round
of mm-hmm. I'm just writing that I'm going to shed light on inherent bias. Okay.
All right. Prod, and then Julie, and I might actually show a story for yours, Julie, and then Ted. Why, Prod? Why was there a lack? You know, I mean, one of the reasons why there may be a lack from, let's say, the UK and Norway and France is that they have their own mediums as well. They have like really strong media. In France and in Norway and in the UK, and they may have some of their own projects going on. So there's an amazing project that I just came across, and I'm like super excited about, called Refugee Journalism Project, and it's like literally people who are refugees who are now in in another country, and they're like, well, we were journalists in our home country, we want to be journalists again, and so it's an entire project that's helping them be able to be journalists, right? They're like, we're not just refugees, thank you very much. You know, we have multiple identities, and they want to be journalists, and they want to be telling stories as journalists who are also refugees, right? And this is something that's in the UK. So that might be one reason. The other reason is just some very specific ideas about what integration means as well. In this European kind of model of the way that, you know, you succeed is that you integrate. So you're not going to be a stranger at home, because if you are, then that means that you failed at integrating, or the system failed at integrating you, because that's the ultimate goal. So that might be another reason. Here I'm partially speculating, but I think that those could be two ideas. Julie, power, absolutely. Just to clarify, on my mother's side, my people came actually at World War I. And in the interwar period. Archduke Ferdinand got shot in Sarajevo, and my great-grandpa heard this and came home and told my great-grandma, we gotta go. And she's like, why we gotta go? And he said, because there's gonna be war. And she said, but you just served in the military, like everything is fine. He's like, no, I'm not worried that the enemy is gonna kill me. I'm worried that my own battalion is gonna kill me, because now they'll have the excuse to do so. So he was, he actually left and came to New York, and then 7 years later sent for the rest of the family. On my father's side, it was World War II. Peter was a producer for 60 Minutes, a really traditional kind of media, and basically started to see that he wasn't seeing things. He had done this piece for 60 Minutes, and he was teaching in the evening at NYU, and he showed the piece to his students, thinking that, you know, his journalism students were going to love it, and one sheepishly kind of raised a hand and said, wow, that's a whole lot of white men. And he had never even seen that. And that was the first time that he said, wait a minute, maybe what, and I'm sorry, Peter, from Praxis, you know, that I'm telling your story for you, but he basically said, maybe we need to actually look at how the sausage is being made. And maybe that's what's important. And I kind of see this project as a way of transparent sausage making for lack of a better term. And it's literally making the process transparent. We literally put a call out and said, we want your stories. And we tried to choose the stories based on what is a good story. Recognizing that the audience was still gonna be a North American audience, right? We're subtitling in English, right? It's still gonna be a North American audience. So the question was, what story do you wanna tell that isn't being told to a North American audience? If I have a second, can I show a story that was a little complicated for me personally? Are you cool with that?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah, okay. So, as I said, I've worked with Romani media for 15 years. I speak Romani, I'm not Roma. I lived in Macedonia. Esma Rajapova is a really, really, really famous musician, Roma musician, but she actually was one of the most famous, and correct me if I'm wrong, musicians in Yugoslavia, period, not Roma specific, right? But she's always said, like, I'm Roma. She also happens to support a really, really right-wing government right now and is quite the puppet in certain ways for this right-wing government. So we wanted Esma because she's a big name, right? She's a big name. She's going to hopefully maybe bring us some money, you know, blah, blah. There's, by the way, just to be very clear, a very big need for money for this project. I've worked on this gratis for 2 years. It's a 2.5-year project and I was paid for 6 months, you know. But, you know, so it was like we wanted a big name and she would do it. But at the same time, I was really concerned about what is she going to say? She's not going to say anything bad about the Macedonian government. And I have some pretty strong opinions about this. But it's not the Shayna show. And so we actually, this is an example of how we had to balance this. So here's Esma's story.
Ano od ova vreme, kad me bijandilum sine but harote ove rom. Kotra ek puti jek čaj ga džikaniva kađatani mena mangavte bešav olaja, ojitani ciganka, ojitani romka. Uvredin džama, ama Mangavte okerav ke ani Makedonija o Romaka na dživdinenta ne bud šukar. Soske amano ustav ogađe diđetane o Romaka i silen nacionalnost. Odeja diskriminacija na je dobrka te penđar olpe ili te dič olpe bud. Mesim prvo Romani džuvli, Romani čaj, koja giljađe Romani gilja, ano Romani čip, ano celo sveto istorijski. Imena la džav so si um romani čaj.
So this was a really interesting situation where, man, there was a lot I wanted to say and do, but this was her story. And the way that we ended up editing it, because we actually helped with the editing on our side, right? Because that's the thing with journalists. It's not just the journalists, but it's the editing. The way that we edited it is like, she is proud of being a Roma. What she was saying also was that the policies that had happened under former Yugoslavia had raised Roma probably better than almost anywhere else in Europe because of those policies. And this is her reality. And we did edit out some of the stuff where she was specifically talking about the current government being great, but we didn't edit out the essence of what she was saying. And that's, I think, what's also important when you're talking about power, is when we're talking about journalism, it's that of the frame. It's what's in the frame, but also what's out of the frame. Always pay attention to what's on the cutting room floor. And this was a really hard one, you know. The last question that I didn't forget, Ted. Where are you, Ted? You know, the last question is, do we need to shed light on the, well, the way I reframed your question, which may not have been actually what you said, is do we need to shed light on the inherent bias in all media? And I would say yes. I would say in some ways what we're trying to do is showing that all media is telling a story. It's just it's usually telling the story of those who are making the story. So that's why I began the talk with the theoretical background of saying that dominant narratives are supporting dominant power structures. So all media is already telling a story. What happens is just that most of the time people aren't aware that they're even doing it.
I think on that note, we should probably bring the session to an end. I'd like to also just say that at SFU, we are also doing our small part to provide maybe one of the many solutions. And we have a person here from it's the Refugee Working Group Committee. And this is comprised of faculty, students, and staff who are trying to come up with solutions to welcome refugees into SFU and to help them to feel more at home here in Vancouver in general and at the university in particular. I'd just like to now thank Shayna for just a wonderful presentation. It was brilliant and really, I think, enjoyed it. And thank you all for your comments and questions. So please, thank you, Shayna.
Thank you.
And one last note, we do quite a bit of programming. We're able, I think, to punch pretty far above our weight, precisely because we have so many incredible allies and co-sponsors. For tonight, in particular, we have SFU Center for the Comparative Study of Muslim Societies and Culture, as well as the Department of Sociology and Anthropology co-sponsoring, helping us out. And so this is really a very key aspect of what we do. We wouldn't be able to do it without their support. We also would not be able to do even a fraction of what we do without the tireless work of Ms. Huyen Pham, who's sitting outside. She does just an amazing job for the Institute. So could I just get a round of applause for her? She's phenomenal. So thank you for coming, and I hope to see you at some of our future events. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much.